Hello friends and enemies, welcome back to the channel. I am Kronk the Book Guy. Today we're going to talk about Throne of Glass by Sarah J. Maas. You see, I'm here to pitch different books to you to help you know if you want to read them for yourself. It's not just telling you my opinion, it's about giving you facts so you can decide what is the right book that you want to try next. So I'm going to be unbiased and just give you the facts. But you got to know, I'm a little biased about this series. I'm not the biggest fan. I don't actually like Throne of Glass all that much. In fact, there are certain books and certain characters and certain subplots that just kind of drive me crazy. Yeah. There's still plenty I do like about it, plenty I respect about it, and about Sarah J. Maas. You might be thinking, why is the Kronk guy going to tell me to read a book series he doesn't actually like? Quite simple. I may not like it, but you might, and that's the more important thing. We're both here to help you find a book that you're going to enjoy. You don't actually need anyone's approval to enjoy the books you like. Not even mine. And I promise, I'll be nice. Mostly. Now, let's begin. The world's greatest assassin is a teenager. Selinda the Assassin lives in a corrupt kingdom, ruled by the tyrannical King of Ardalan. The king has somehow cursed his own land and banished all magic. Now he rules unopposed with an iron fist. Selina has been a prisoner in a labor camp for over a year. She's been dreaming of killing that evil king who put her there. Until one day, the super sexy royal prince Dorian shows up with his super sexy captain of the guards, Kale. And the two of them have come to free Selina, so that she can compete in a tournament for assassins. Yeah, like in a Assassin Olympics. Ugh. The winning assassin will get to serve as the King of Ardalan's protector and special one-on-one assassin. Selina has every intention of winning this tournament so that she can get close enough to her real target. You've got to know this up front. Throne of Glass is what we call a gateway fantasy. Let me explain. This means it's like fantasy for beginners. It's very soft and light on the fantasy side of things. There's no 10,000 years of history or 20 different countries with their own political alignment and all these, you know, thousands of characters. No, Throne of Glass is very easy to pick up and start reading. You can understand it straight away. That's half the reason why this series has been such a phenomenon in the book publishing industry. It's a permanent bestseller and has been for nearly 10 years now. The series is also pitched at young adults, something also very important to keep in mind. So for many teenagers, this will be their first introduction into the fantasy genre, at least in book form. And for many more, this is going to be their first fantasy book. Naturally, they're going to think, this is the best series ever. Why? Well, because they haven't read any other fantasy books to compare it to, and even the worst fantasy is much better than any other genre. Unfortunately, a lot of older readers that are established in the fantasy genre, they tend to gatekeep this sort of thing. So stuff that's, you know, light and easy and simple to begin with, or often in the young adult genre. And the older ones will say, oh, that's not real fantasy. You know, get yourself a real book. Try a better series than that. And generally, we can just be a big old clump of negativity to anyone who's coming into the genre. In short, fantasy fans, including myself, can be snobs. Can I just say, let's all agree to not do that. So yes, Throne of Glass will never be in the same league of fantasy such as Wheel of Time or Malazan, Book of the Fallen, in terms of deaths and complexity. But we need to remember the crucial role that gateway fantasy play in the fantasy community and in the wider book industry as well. So gateway series are vital for getting more people into the genres. So for example, Star Wars is a light and easy series to help interest people and get them on board to science fiction until they're ready for a more complex and higher form of science fiction like Star Trek. So obviously Star Wars and Star Trek are both good franchises on their own, but one will have a wider appeal. You might consider it quicker, more seductive.
But is your more seductive?
Where the other one is a bit more sophisticated. But that's a really good thing. Fantasy books are similar. So people love to bash on Aragon. It's me, I'm people. But it introduced the next generation, Star Trek pun, to fantasy. helping them explore other series. So Throne of Glass is a hugely popular gateway, and for that it needs to be celebrated. Each of us in the fantasy genre who regularly read it will have had a book that got us into the genre in the first place. It may not be a book that we enjoy as much today, it may not have aged well, but those books are very important for getting new people into the genre. So while I might make a crack or two, I might mock this series a little bit during this video because I can't really help it, but I genuinely do appreciate the fact that it's bringing more readers in. And if you're a new reader to fantasy and Throne of Glass is your introduction, hey, welcome. I'm really glad you're here. And go at your own rate. You don't have to go straight from this to something heavier. You can just stay in the gateway area for a while. That's great. Read whatever you like, okay? Now let's actually discuss Throne of Glass. I know, crazy. The main plot lines revolve around Selena, working to take down the evil king of Ardalan and free the world from his tyranny. So magic has been sealed away somehow, we're not quite sure how he did it, and the magically gifted, without their power to protect them, are now an oppressed minority. So there's also an ancient mystery hiding under the castle that hints at a greater evil still secretly menacing the world from the shadows. Much of the earlier books take place in that aforementioned glass castle where the King of Ardalan rules. Also, side note, the King of Ardalan, our great villain, he doesn't actually have a name. It's weird. I don't get it. There's great effort in the text to avoid mentioning his name. I mean, his son has a last name. Don't think about it too much, okay? Just roll with it. Anyway, the characters all spend a large amount of time in that glass castle. So some of them work together, some of them work against each other. It's a game of shadows, if you will. There's a whole lot of sneaking. Also, the castle has this insane amount of secret entrances and secret tunnels that have all been hidden for millennia, and yet somehow our teenage protagonists can find them quickly and easily. Don't think about it too much. Throne of Glass also doubles as a romance series. Now, major plot lines and screen times are devoted to that glorious beast known as sexual tension. It's the whole will they or won't they that really intrigues you into finding out which of these characters actually have the chemistry. Who is she going to end? Is Selena going to end up with? The serious captain of the guards or the charming introverted prince? Like, it's so trashy, but we love it. Right? It's a lot of fun. I'm serious.
Really, I mean that. Sorry if it sounded sarcastic.
The romance aspect ended up being a major attraction. Romance pun. For readers when the series was in its publication cycle. Because we were all wondering, who are they going to end up with? Which couple do you ship with which person do you ship into which couple? You know, and everyone had their own thoughts and opinions on it. So that is something that you will enjoy getting into it. No matter what your preference is in the romance genre, it is a fun aspect. But we're going to come back to plot lines because the series changes in its later half. For now, let's move on to characters. So Selena, the teenage assassin, is our main character and heroine. She was orphaned and grew up on the streets until she was taken in by a gang of criminals and assassins. And eventually, her gang sold her out and she went into that labor camp where we find her at the start of book one. Now, Selena is an interesting character to me. She's a bit like the Jon Snow or the Rambo, you know, that tough character who can fight her way through any obstacle. She's great in that sense, but she's also angry all the time. To the point where she's almost a one-note character. What's her reaction going to be to this? Angry. What's her reaction to that one? Angry. And every time she says anything, it reminds me of Frank Burns from MASH. This is probably a way too old of a reference considering this is a young adult series. But MASH, back in the 70s, had Frank Burns, and his whole thing was that he was ready to fight as soon as a conversation started. He was pre-angry all the time.
Hi, Frank.
Hello, Frank. That'll be the day.
And that's exactly what Selena is like. Now, to be fair, she has good reasons to be angry all the time, but a lot of people just simply find her annoying as a main character. When I started reading the series, people warned me, oh, Kronk, you're gonna hate the main character for the first three books. I'm like, that's insane! Why would I read three books for a main character I don't even like? Just to be clear, I'm not actually criticizing this. Okay, I genuinely love seeing a female character who can speak her mind, who can be angry, who's not trying to please everyone in her life. That's something I think we need more of. That's just my opinion. What I do have an issue with it is it becomes repetitive. it becomes very repetitive to the point where angry Selena becomes frustrating and the story goes in a big circle and it just becomes boring, right? It loses its impact if you're just angry all the time. The point is, she is a divisive main character. You may love her, you may hate her. There's not really anyone who's in the middle in terms of whether they like her or not, so give it a try, decide for yourself. Prince Dorian, on the other hand, he is a sexy hunk of a prince. He reads books all the time, and he's so introverted, and he doesn't know how cute he is. This is going to be a long video. He's so smart and hardworking, but his dad is the evil king, and he's just so mean to Dorian all the time. And Dorian tries to make his father proud, and he cares about his people, and he always works to do the right thing, but if only someone would just appreciate him the way he deserves. Captain Kale, on the other hand, is the super sexy hunk of a captain of the guards. Oh yeah, he's so serious all the time. He's always working or training or working out, and that physique, He's so dedicated to his duty, but he's racked with self-doubt, to the point where he sulks and broods all the time, and he worries that he'll never be good enough, and all that hard work won't make a difference if only someone would love him the way he deserves. And then there's Rowan, the super sexy fae with the impossible physique. Oh, young adult fiction. For 5 minutes, could you not be so cheesy?
For 5 minutes!
But do you see the trend here, okay? There's a wide cast of characters in the series, but most of them are a form of wish fulfillment, right? They're all impossibly sexy, they're all untouchable in combat, and win every fight kinda easily, and they're always just so tortured by their tragic personal problems. Again, I'm not criticizing it, really. After all, this is why superhero movies are so popular. We like seeing a big badass character with a hammer smashing stuff and having no problems against, you know, a bunch of enemies, because it's fun and it makes us feel invincible and it helps us escape from our daily lives. And in that sense, that's exactly what Throne of Glass does, and it does it terrifically. It's escapist fantasy. The characters are crazy powerful, the romance is super addictive, the world is just so easy to slip into. That's what the series is all about. One final thing on characters. So Sarah J. Maas is actually widely praised for her character writing. And when I realized that, I was kind of conflicted, because in my experience, a lot of them were one-note characters. There was the angry one, or the serious one, or the self-doubting one, you know? But when you really think about it, it's less about she makes her characters really well written and more that she can make out her audience very much care about those characters. And that's the distinction. She knows how to get us invested. If you're wondering how she does that, well, I'll get back to that one. The second elephant in the room is the cringe. Okay, so we've got to talk about some of the just plain terrible writing in the series. So there are some really cringy lines of dialogue all across the series. Every character has it. There's descriptions that are so melodramatic and over the top, and there are character interactions where they're speaking and they just don't sound like real people at all. And oh my god, the overuse of the word snarl is atrocious. Like seriously, everyone snarls at the end of their sentence. So if there's no Dorian whispered, Kale shouted, Selena said, no, it's they snarl everything. And it's like if you took a shot of vodka every time someone said snarl, you wouldn't make it through chapter one. Sounds like a good time though. And it's just like she keeps using that word and I do not think it means what she thinks it does.
You keep using that word. I do not think it means what you think it means.
So I have to warn you what you're getting in for, okay? If this stuff doesn't bother you, that's great. Just forget I said anything. Just go read it and enjoy it for what it is. If you're someone who normally likes prose and enjoys the more poetic aspect of a book, this might really frustrate you, and I would genuinely recommend try the series on audiobook. Personally, I don't fixate so much on prose if it's been read to me, and I also find that the narrators do a really good job of sort of skimming over the rougher lines and just kind of using that tone of voice to help make them flow a bit better. So that's just a pro tip. Why do I bring up all these problems? I mean, aren't I pitching this series to you? I'm bringing up some of the earlier problems because this series improves with time. The plot lines get better. The character writing gets better. The cringy writing eases somewhat. a little. If it were up to me, we'd actually split this series down the middle. I find it weird that the publishers just made the whole thing the Throne of Glass series. I genuinely recommend seeing it more as the Throne of Glass quadrilogy of the first four books, and then the Empire of Storms trilogy. Because they are basically two different stories. I really wish I could explain this more in detail, because I have many thoughts on it, but there's massive spoilers I want to avoid about book four in particular. But I'll summarize by saying the first four books really do focus on that game of shadows, assassins in the night, swordplay, and romantic plot lines. Whereas in the last three novels are about epic clashes of magical powers, forming military alliances, and assembling of vast armies. And challenging powerful ancient evils, there's even portals into parallel dimensions. Yeah, it gets lit. I'm telling you, series two, there's some good stuff in there. It's also worth noting, series two has a sudden increase in erotic writing. And that leads me to... Okay, time to talk about that smut. Time to get smutty. Whip out your saxophones, everyone. Time to dim the lights. Our old friend, Sexual Tension, well, he's there from book one. But most of the smut is pretty light in the early parts of the series. There is sex, but it's not explicit. But from book five onwards, we get sex scenes that are more detailed in their encounters, and even specific sexual acts that are described in erotic detail. Now, before you turn into an old prude and go, ew, yuck, sex, this is not for me, just hear me out for a second, I want to make a point. I would like to present a thought for your consideration. This issue should not be whether or not there is sex in the books or not. I think the issue should be, is it healthy sex or unhealthy sex? That's a more important question I think we should normalize in this context. So, for example, are both partners in the scene being respected? Are they both having their needs met? And is it consensual, or is the issue of consent not clearly discussed? What about protection? Is someone being a selfish lover? Is there abuse or coercion? All of that is more important than whether or not the sex exists. It's about whether it's of good quality and whether it's healthy. But that's just my thoughts. That's just my opinion. I'll leave that with you. Now, the smut in this series is widely praised, but I also want to stress it's actually not that intense. So in the same way that Throne of Glass is a gateway into fantasy, it's also a gateway into erotica. Which means it's pretty light and simple on that side of things. It's not that intense. You might say it's like a 3 or 4 out of 10 on the erotica intensity scale. It has led to a rise in other readers reading the series as an introduction and going, oh, I want to go read more erotica. And you know what? Great. Great, good for you. Anything that gets you reading gets me happy. I mean, I am not going to be introducing erotica series on this channel anytime soon or ever, but hey, read what you like, not what I tell you to read, okay? So that's how the erotica fits in this series. And it really is only intense from book five onwards. The books actually do come with a mature content warning on the back of it from those books onwards. So for representation, Throne of Glass has an excellent representation of women in particular. It's what the series is quite famous for. There's also so many different personalities within the female characters. You know, diversity within the gender. There is significantly less LGBT rep, though. The series mostly just has throwaway lines referring to someone's sexuality. It's not necessarily shown. There's none of those stories told. There are two instances of same-sex couples on screen, but that's kind of it. I have seen Sarah Maas take some criticism for this, for not including more of this community in her wider works, but I actually think it's something I want to forgive, because her real representation strength is in how she represents a range of mental health issues. This is her focus point as a writer. She's going to represent depression, anxiety, grief, trauma, PTSD, all sorts of serious situations like that. She even has representation for physical disability as well. Remember how I said earlier in the character section, Sarah J. Maas makes us care about these characters? This is how. Almost all of her characters have some form of mental illness. I have actually read everything Sarah J. Maas has written of the time of filming in May 2023, so that's her full collection. I would say that mental health is a major theme in all of her works and in all of her characterizations. She is a huge advocate for it, both in her creative work and in her personal life as well. I think this is why people care about her characters so much, because we are seeing in them the validation for our own struggles, our own challenges, and our own mental illnesses. Some of us go through trauma and abuse, and we end up angry like Selena. Others will go through trauma and abuse and will end up closed off and depressed and walled up like Kale. And that's what really draws readers into the Throne of Glass series. We see ourselves represented and we may not even necessarily know how much we needed that. So reading order, there are 7 novels in this series and 1 collection of novellas that is a prequel. I'm honestly not sure where you should start. Let me explain the context. Now, I have slammed Sarah J. Maas a little bit in this video, but I have a huge amount of respect and admiration for her because as a famous author, she is almost entirely self-made. That's a huge accomplishment. So she got her start in writing by posting short stories and novellas online for free on the website Fiction Press. She wrote the opening chapters as well for Throne of Glass, and she got a following. She was one of the biggest authors on that channel, where people just posted free fan fiction or free portions of their own work. After her work had a significant number of views on this site, she began pitching her new book to publishers and pointing at her massive online following as proof of the marketability of her writing, and it worked. Throne of Glass was published and almost immediately became a big success because she went straight through Bloomsbury, the biggest publishing house just about out there for young adult fantasy. Since her publication, her online work has been taken down. Now you have to pay for it, of course. However, those online short stories and novellas she published, they are now have been compiled into this first collection, Assassin's Blade. So that's where that sits. It's a prequel collection. The question is here, should you start with where the story originally began or with the first novel? And I'm not quite sure what to tell you, but for context, remember how Selena is so angry it's kind of annoying, right? Well, that's because of the events that take place in the novellas. In the novellas, she's a bit more mellow as a character, then some stuff goes down, and by the time the first novel comes around, she's a bit more bitter. I found that after I read the novellas, I was much more sympathetic to Selena. I even liked her a little bit once I realized why she was fighting against the entire world. I personally wish that I had read the prequels first. But if you're unsure how much of the series you want to try, if you're like, I don't know if I want to read all 8 books that are in this, maybe just start with the one, Throne of Glass. So Tower of Dawn is just a weird novel. I don't even know how to explain it. So Tower of Dawn occurs at the exact same time of Empire of Storms. So these two novels take place in 2 different countries with 2 different protagonists at a concurrently. So Tower of Dawn focuses on Kale, the former captain of the guards. He travels south to a different continent looking for allies in the Great War that's going on at this point in the story. Most of the other main characters don't appear in the story. It's pretty much him. You know, he's the guy who sulks all the time. Fun. Yeah, I'm not going to sugarcoat it. Tower of Dawn was hands down my least favorite novel in the series. There are some really good romance plot lines that get lots of attention, but the main plot line just feels painfully detached from the rest of everything else that we've read about. And even once we read the final book, Tower of Dawn didn't really contribute that much. It really was disconnected. It felt irrelevant. I'm slamming it pretty hard, okay? A lot of people will disagree with me. I've had people say Tower of Dawn is their favorite because the romance in it was so well written. It truly is, but it's a weird deviation when we're that close to the ending. I did have one friend who didn't even realize Tower of Dawn was in the series, and he accidentally read Empire of Storms and Kingdom of Ash, skipping it, and missed nothing. He felt that he could fully comprehend the full story. So, I'm not telling you what to do, but I couldn't talk about this series without mentioning this weird outlier of a novel that doesn't quite fit with the rest of the series. The ending. Is the ending worth reading? Look, unfortunately, once again, I don't know. I'm not sure how to answer it without spoilers, and it depends on a few things, but the final book does offer a proper, satisfying conclusion, and it manages to wrap up every last plot line. Of course, it is 1,000 pages long, and it is significantly longer than anything else in the series, so with 1,000 pages, you can wrap up just about anything, right? Any kind of present if you've got that much paper. I did think Kingdom of Ash was one of the stronger books in the series. At the same time, I'm going to include very small spoilers here, okay? Just skip to the time on the screen, which I'll figure out how to do, to avoid the spoilers. Here we go. 3, 2, 1. My problem with the final book is that the ending was too safe. It was too neat and tidy. Everyone's happy. Yes, while that is very common for YA gateway fantasies, it lacks that finesse of reality. Think of it as Lord of the Rings, where Frodo destroys the ring and then is happy from that point on, goes home back to the Shire and lives happily out for the rest of his days. It doesn't account for the trauma, for the effects that the journey has changed in him. Frodo has to go to the Outer Shores and leave his friends, right? Imagine a story ending without that bittersweet finale, and it's kind of lame and it falls flat. Okay, sorry about the spoilers. Spoilers over. No more spoilers. Okay, so how much should you try? This is yet another tough question. So I do think the first novel is a fair sample of the rest of the series on a whole. But at the same time, I personally thought Queen of Shadows was the first book I actually enjoyed in the series. So if you're a completionist like me, maybe push through to the fourth book. Otherwise, if you don't love the first book, you don't have to read on. The first book is a pretty fair sampling. Okay, well, that was thrown a glass. I got through it. I managed not to mock it too hard. I hope I have genuinely piqued your curiosity and you want to try this series. And even if you know, like me, this isn't a series that's aimed for you, I hope you have at least to convince you to be nice to other people in the community, in the fantasy community, who want to enjoy it, and don't judge them. I hope we can celebrate gateway fantasy books and celebrate new people coming in. Besides, if you don't like throwing a glass, just check out the other videos on my channel. I've got heaps of stuff and other series that I'm pitching to you. You can do the YouTube stuff now, or you click the like button and subscribe. Comment your thoughts on this video. Comment your thoughts on gateway fantasy and romance and erotica. I want to hear all about it. Seriously, your comments do help the channel. You can also ask about other series on my bookshelf that you want to see. Keep in mind, I actually have 8 bookshelves and these are just 3 of them. Remember to support the channel by checking out our shop. You can buy this shirt of a random circular door that has no affiliation to any franchise you might have known about. But check out the shop Rainbow Space Unicorn for magical bookish accessories. Treat yourself to a book today, and I'll see you next time. Thanks for joining me. Bye bye.